Hello, everyone, and welcome to this week's TDU Live. I'm Mike, and this week we have Dorien Gunnels with us. But first, I want to do a couple announcements real quick. First off, we have a brand new lighting challenge that we just started up this week. So check out the lighting community for details on that. It's a very cool attic scene done by Alex Mateo and Jeremy Vickery. The lighting community is growing by leaps and bounds. I think we got over 40 new people this week, and that's huge. So we're really excited about that. The Redshift class is coming. Shane is finishing up the lectures now. We should have that for you in the very near future, hopefully. And then the bunny that we've been talking about for a while. The materials have been final. We're just getting the rig together, the animation together, and we should have more updates for you on that soon. But without much further ado, let's first, I'm going to show you guys Dorien's demo reel, and then I will show you Dorien himself, and then we will go from there. So let's make me small and this bigger, and then... So now let's bring in, oh, let's not have that play again. Hold on. There we go. So as you guys know, if you've read his bio, we've got Dorien Gunnels. Dorien has an over a decade of experience as a digital artist specializing in lighting and compositing on feature films. He's worked at pretty much every major studio. As you can see, he's worked at Pixar, DreamWorks, Sony, and I had the pleasure of working with him the last 6 or 9 months or so here at Blue Sky Studios. And now we're going to bring and Dorien, his lighting credits include Spies in Disguise, Incredibles 2, Cars 3, Hotels Transylvania 2, How to Train Your Dragon 2, and many, many more. Dorien Gunnels, welcome to TDU Live.
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing great. Switch you and make you bigger.
Yeah,
there.
I forgot how much I love that song. It's so panicked, right?
Yeah.
So you're just like, this will work fine, whatever.
No, that's great. Thank you for taking the time to join us. So, Dorien, we're going to be talking to you today about, first off, we want to just know a little bit about you. So can you just tell us where you're from and where you grew up?
So I grew up in Anderson, South Carolina. My mom was an artist. She's now an art teacher. At the time, she was a graphic designer when I was little. Mm-hmm. And I kind of just got into art that way.
So you grew up like being very, very interested in art.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So what were you? So how do would you say like your mom's influence, like being around that environment, has affected you now as an adult, grown man, artist, career man?
Well, in those early days, you know, again, she was a graphic designer, but then also my dad did like videography work. Mm-hmm. So we actually had like this like big 90s camcorder around and stuff. So I used to like run around and like. Who trusts a 9-year-old with like thousands of dollars worth of equipment? It's not really. but you know, they would let me like, you know, set it up on a tripod, and I made like little stop motion films. You remember the show Gumby?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, so I used to really like that when I was little, and like I used to want to, you know, take Play-Doh and like modeling clay and like move it around. You know, the whole like 2-frame rule, I had no control over that. So it was like record stop. Yeah, just making stuff like that.
That's really
good. I'm sorry?
Oh, no, that's really great. When did you start getting an interest in animation?
I saw the first Toy Story in theaters. And that was, it was that and the show Reboot.
Oh, wow, nice. I forgot about that show.
Yeah, no, it was really cool. And then when it was funny, when I started at DreamWorks, my supervisor was like, credited as like one of the first people to be working on Reboot, which of course I kind of fanboyed out a little bit.
That's one of the fun things about this industry is you get to meet people who worked on some of your favorite films ever, and it's just like it just blows you away sometimes. Yeah. So where did you go to college?
I went to two. Mm-hmm. I went to Anderson University, in my hometown.
Okay.
And at the time that was because I didn't quite know how to get into animation.
Right. So, but at that time, you knew you wanted to do animation.
I knew I wanted to go into animation since Toy Story,
wow.
Which is bizarre to think about. But you know, it's one of those things where it's not a lot of people really knew exactly the path to get there. So I wasn't sure if it was going to happen. Mm-hmm. So I did go under kind of what my mom was going to do, which is graphic design. So I went to Anderson University's graphic design, and I had a professor that was kind of coaching me through some stuff, and then we just kind of realized that the class is very specific animation. They just didn't offer them.
Mm-hmm.
So she recommended that I go to SCAD, mm-hmm. In Savannah, Georgia. And I did that, and I guess the rest is history.
Yes.
It's through SCAD that I made a lot of friends. The professors there were super helpful. You make a lot of connections that way.
See, we didn't have, if you'd have just not gone to Anderson, we could have had overlap at SCAD and we could have hung out then, but man,
oh, that's where you went.
You blew it. You blew it, buddy. I'm just older than you. So, okay. So did you always want to go into lighting? Was that your focus, or did you just want to work on animated films in general?
It was work on animated films in general. And then once I got to SCAD, I thought that I wanted to go into modeling.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why I thought that in hindsight, because I'm a pretty terrible modeler. But, you know, in general...
Well, that's a moot point to the thing. You just do it.
Yeah. But in general, I thought that maybe I would just actually go into animation.
Mm-hmm.
Make the characters move. And I had another professor that... professors are golden. They give you all this like golden advice and all this. She said, when you walk through Forsyth Park, which is in Savannah...
Mm-hmm.
What do you look at? Do you look at the people or do you look at the leaves on the trees? And I admitted that I look at the leaves on the trees because that like fascinated me, the way that, you know, the light plays, the shadows play, also the movements of the leaves. And she said, no, you need to go into VFX, not animation. And I was like, oh, okay. All right. And I just took that advice, which, you know, so SCAD has two different degrees. There's animation and there's VFX. And then through lighting, I'm really into photography.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that kind of really matched up.
That's incredible. So I love these like life-changing moments when it's just a matter of someone asking you whether or not you look at the leaves or the people in the park, and that changes the course of your future for many years to come. That's amazing.
Admitting to yourself, what do you really enjoy?
Yeah.
And you didn't follow that, you know, if you can. Sometimes it's not always possible.
So you were at SCAD. Talk to us a little bit about how you transitioned from college student to working professional. Like, what was your first job? Was there a long time? Were you applying for jobs for a while out of school?
I got super lucky. So again, as you know, like getting a job here is like, it's almost more who you know.
Sure.
And that came into play immediately. I had my best friend, he got a job at DreamWorks, they call them lighting TAs. And he mentioned, he graduated a year before, and he sent me a text, and he's like, hey, DreamWorks is looking for more lighting TAs, you should apply. Like, oh, God, that sounds great, I'll do that. And I think it was about 3 months from graduating. And so the response that I got back was both terrible and awesome. they said, okay, we're not going to interview as a lighting TA, unfortunately. I was like, oh.
Yeah.
And then they said, well, instead, we actually really need lighting artists.
Oh.
So would you like to apply for that? I was like, I interviewed as a lighting artist. The interview process was super intense because I think at the time, this was during Megamind, around 2010. I think there was some debate on whether or not they needed somebody down in Los Angeles or if they needed somebody in the Bay Area.
Mm-hmm.
So I ended up going through 5 different interviews. Kind of passed around from supervisor to supervisor.
Wait, like 5 different instances? Were these on the phone or were you in person?
These were over a video chat like this,
yeah.
Except it wasn't like a Skype thing. They sent me to a facility where there were these like video conference facilities that you have to go to. They wouldn't do this now.
Yeah.
I think this is right on the edge of where it's like everybody uses GChat or everybody uses FaceTime, or so I wasn't in my living room.
That's insane. So so you had to go to a video conference chat office facility in Savannah, Georgia to talk to them.
This was at home.
This was back in South Carolina?
It was about 20 minutes away from where I left.
Oh, okay.
I was still like picking up and going to a facility just to have a video chat.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody like here.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of insane to think of now, right?
Yeah. So in the interview process, can you just like, because I know a lot of our students are probably wondering what it's like to be interviewed by DreamWorks for a lighting position. Could you tell us a little, like, were they looking at your demo reel and asking you questions? Were they like, what were they looking for, like specific software knowledge, or what were they looking for out of your demo reel?
I would say as a student, they were pretty forgiving.
Yeah.
Because they know you don't really know anything. Like, if you're a student that thinks you know everything, you don't.
Right.
You really don't. And it's
except for if you're a TDU student, in which case you're a bunch better.
Sure. But the work experience, it matters, right?
Yeah.
And kind of
for
going
sure.
through the grind. And you haven't gone through the grind yet. And to your benefit, they know that. So they're going to interview you accordingly. But what they end up doing is they just talked about, what do I look at when I start a shot? What do I think about? I went through 5 different interviews, which they really range. Some of them were just kind of personal talks. I'm like, how's your day? And then other ones were super technical. And there were some answers that I just straight up didn't know. And I think during those times, a good piece of advice is to admit when you don't know something. Because sometimes, I think, definitely in a couple of the questions, they knew I wouldn't know.
Yeah.
Because they were actually proprietary things that they had. So if I tried to BS my way through it, they know.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of a test to see if you're actually going to tell the truth, if you're kind of an honest, and in general, how personable you are, how's your communication skills, things like that.
No, that's great. I've said that about interview, because there's all these like interview tricks that people do. And one of them is to ask you questions they know you don't know the answer to see how you react to that. Another one that I recently heard that was interesting was they'll say, if you're working at a job, like, when can you start? And if you say, I can start first thing Monday morning, that's like a big red flag, because they want you to say, well, I'm currently at this facility. I need to give them proper notice. So it'll be a month before, you want to show respect to your old jobs because you're going to show respect to the new job too. So I always tell people, like, just be honest and be a good person, and that'll read through in your interview process. So,
also, don't come across as too aggressive. Honestly,
yeah.
It's a turnoff in regular conversation. It's also a turnoff in job interviews as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so you went through five interviews at some strange, I'm trying to picture what the Skype facility, Okay. So then, they extended the job offer and then, so you moved out to LA to be a lighter on Megamind?
San Francisco. So, interesting. So DreamWorks at the time had two facilities in the US. One was in Glendale, which is whenever they show the publicity stills for DreamWorks, they show you Los Angeles.
Yes.
And, but I went up to PDI, which, it was funny because I really, really wanted to go to LA. They actually asked me, would you rather go to Los Angeles or up to PDI? And I said Los Angeles, and their response was, too bad, you're going to San Francisco.
Like, why even ask me?
Yeah, exactly. But it honestly, in hindsight, like, I wouldn't change anything about it because, again, like San Francisco was never really on my radar, but it was a cultural experience for me. Again, coming from South Carolina, big city, San Francisco is walkable. You know, the commute down to Redwood City, which is where PDI was pretty awesome. So it was a great kind of life experience for me. As far as the actual work experience, it was great as well. I think in hindsight, I probably stressed a little bit too much, just because it's like, you're the new guy. This you've worked years and years to get to where you are, and then suddenly you're there, and then it's kind of hard to calm down from that. At least it was for me.
It takes time to have the confidence that you know what you're doing and that you're going to do a good job and to just kind of settle into it a little bit. And that's totally natural. It's totally natural to be overly cautious and overly worried when you're first getting started. So that's,
Well, and that's the thing, the experience that I was talking about, as a student, you don't really know anything. When you get that experience, you're proving to employers, I can do this, but you're also proving to yourself.
Yeah.
No, and that was one of the things that actually at Pixar hit me where, because I always put, it's one of those people that put Pixar on this huge pedestal.
Mm-hmm.
And, when I got there, I was terrified, even though, I had been working for about 7 years. But I was still terrified. I felt totally outclassed by, every single lighter that was there. As I started working, I was like, oh, I got this. Mm-hmm. I can do this. And then, along with that confidence in myself, there came confidence, from the supervisors, other leads. And, it just leads to a better working relationship if you could just go, no, I got this. Just chill out.
That's great. So did you transition from PDI to Pixar then? Was that your step?
No. So when PDI closed it was 2015. There was this exodus of people that went up to Vancouver.
Oh, right.
That's where the work was at the time. So I went up to Sony Imageworks.
Right.
And I worked on Hotel Transylvania 2 and Sparks.
Nice.
So I enjoyed Vancouver for about a year and a half.
Great.
And then went to Pixar for another year and a half.
Okay.
And came and met this dude named Mike Pinzillo.
And your life has been different forever.
For the better.
For the better. Yeah. So, So Dorien and I were working together on Spies in Disguise, which should be coming out in the autumn, we think. Okay. So I want to talk to you about one of the things that we talked about early when we met. And this was that one of the productions that you worked on worked a little differently than we're used to working. Normally, as we teach in the TDU course, the lighting and animated film, you'll have a master lighter who goes in and master lights a handful of shots and creates the look along with the director and art director and all that. And then based on those handful of master shots, you then go back in and set up lighting shots and an army of lighters comes in and they grab the master rig and they go from there. So one of the projects that you worked on, you actually worked on, was it one sequence for the entire production?
No, it was multiple sequences.
But you were like the main, but it was really just like one or two lighters doing all the work on the sequence. And so it was more, And I just kind of wanted to talk to you about how you found that process. Did you find that works better? Did it have, like, the positives and negatives of that?
So on that particular show. I came on a little bit later in the show, so a lot of the kinks have been kind of worked out. So for me, it was super, super smooth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the thing about a lot of shows is that, you know, you have to be very flexible in the way that you work. You know, if you're used to working only one way, you only want to work that way, you're not going to, life's not going to be easy because every single show is different.
Mm-hmm.
But in this particular one, this one was at Pixar, they mostly had one lighter per sequence, not as a rule because that wasn't, you know, some sequences are just too complicated for one lighter to light.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, it was possible for one lighter to light the whole sequence, which, like you said, is not normally done. And it was a little bit of an experiment for them. And with varying opinions on the success.
Uh-huh.
I really enjoyed it. I know some people didn't really like it as much. And I'm not sure if they're going to continue that. I don't know.
Okay.
But for me, it was kind of nice. Terrifying, because you kind of don't want to be the one set of shots that look
yeah.
But at the same time, you know, you own the look from the very beginning. And what they also did in that show was they, we get to light very early on mm-hmm. in the life of the sequence. So usually, like, you know, as you can probably attest to, in a lot of shows, we are given something from layout, it's already got animation in it, it's already, you know, it's pretty much a real shot.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, we need to put lights into it and render it, right? And then, you know, there might be some redo stuff and all that, but for the most part, it's kind of a done thing.
Right.
This one was like, you know, I got it and the city wasn't even really set up. And they're just like, no, they just start throwing in sky domes and like work very, very, very broadly. And it's like, okay. And then everything was very iterative. We were working on getting just general color down.
Mm-hmm.
Like, not getting lost in the weeds on like shaping a character.
That's great.
Not even sure if the character was going to still be there. you know, and it's, again, it's an exercise in flexibility.
And I'm guessing that having the lighting cues early helped the layout artist, the camera artist, the animators really get a good understanding of where they should focus their attention, because that's where the focus of the shot's going to be.
Yeah, and one of the things that they, some of the feedback that the lighting department got from animation was that this maybe played a little bit more on other sequences than online, but some of the stuff is super dramatic, right?
Sure.
So if the idea is like a character has to like lean into light, well, it kind of helps to know where that light's going to be. But under a normal pipeline, I'm assuming the animator just has to guess because they don't actually have light, right?
Yeah.
So there's this like back and forth that's in some ways kind of a waste of time, because they kind of do their thing, we do our thing, and then they're like, oh, our thing didn't work, so then they readjust theirs.
Yeah.
And it's the tug of war, right? So, but in that one, it was they were able to play off our lighting a little bit.
That's good. Yeah, I always feel bad for an effects artist who makes like a really cool effect, and they give it to me, and I'm like, ooh, it's going to be out of focus because it's in the background. Like, and you may put it out of, and you're like, ooh, sorry about that. And it's just kind of, yeah, it's good. It's, and you know, like if we could have shown them that early on, they wouldn't have wasted those cycles.
Yeah. And one of the things that really helped was the DP on that show, he had done some live action stuff as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of the keys that he kind of painted for us for the sequences even came with like, okay, here's what I envision for a very general light.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just like, you know, if it's an outdoor thing, he's like, skylight, that's almost it.
Mm-hmm.
But then in general, like if it's an indoor sequence, you know, how would you actually light that shot in real life?
Yeah.
So it's over here, like, you know, we're going to balloon a light over here. We're going to put a softbox over here. We'll, okay, we have our window over here, so here's what I envision for like a general rig for that.
Mm-hmm.
And it helped to have him already have thought through that, and then you're kind of executing it at first. And so your first pass is really just creating the rig that he put together,
mm-hmm.
and then adjusting from there. And there's a lot of adjustments for sure, but it really gave us a really great foundation.
That's
and
great.
A place to start a conversation. And that's where a lot of the art comes from. It's
that's great.
Conversation that happens afterwards.
It's awesome. All right, Dorien, we have a rapid fire list of questions, but before I do that, I want to encourage everyone who's watching, if you have questions for Dorien, feel free to write them in the comments below. We'll go through the rapid fire and then we'll circle back around and see if we have any user questions. So Dorien, are you ready for this?
Sure.
All right. So you've worked on a lot of films over your time. And I know that different films have different financial success or critical success. Is there any one project that you are most proud of that you worked on? Is there any one film or one sequence or even one shot?
I like them all. I know that's a cop-out answer.
Oh, that is such a cop-out answer.
Honestly, it's the emotion of working on them. So it's like, you know, working on Madagascar 3 was pretty awesome. Because, you know, all the people that I worked with, I guess the most recent one, I'm really proud of the work on Incredibles 2. Because I got to own that in a very unique way.
Yeah.
Coco was super fun.
Let me ask you this in a different way, because one of our students, actually, they asked, Calabaza Moele asks, and this is a good one, which is the most difficult shot that you've worked on?
Oh, man. Most difficult.
Yeah, can't cap out of this one, can you? They're all difficult. Nope.
Yeah, no. honestly, well, I have to say, like, I mean, man, it's the most difficult. Again, because it was, and I said it was smooth, but again, it was the fear of working on the Incredibles 2 stuff while owning it completely. And so I wouldn't say it wasn't the most technically difficult that I've worked on, but it was definitely artistically and almost emotionally the most difficult was a lot of the Incredibles 2 stuff. Because, again, it's this extra weight on your shoulders of making sure he's on par with everything that's already come before, which already looked amazing. And just trying to make sure you blend in, and you're not the only sequence on the movie.
That's great. Okay, so rapid fire questions. What was your favorite film as a child?
Not so much child, Lord of the Rings.
Okay.
I was a huge Lord of the Rings nut, and I think I've actually watched the behind the scenes Lord of the Rings more than I've ever watched the actual Lord of the Rings. Seriously, I think there was a time when I was watching it basically.
That's amazing.
It's super fascinating if you haven't watched it. I know it's like 12 hours of footage or something like that, but definitely watch it. It's super.
Deal. Do you have any, what sound or noise do you love or hate?
So again, I'm from South Carolina, and one of the things that we don't get on the West Coast is raging thunderstorms. So I really like the sound of just a massive effing thunderstorm that's just rolling through, and you can't hear anything because the thunder's too loud. I really like that.
Cool. So you've worked on animated films for a long time now, but is there another profession out there that you would be interested in attempting outside of film or visual effects or animation?
Would it have to be money making?
No, totally not. Actually, probably better if it isn't.
Yeah, I really like music.
Nice.
So I'm a musician. I play guitar, bass. I've recently gotten into electronic music because that's the thing. I have a modular synthesizer that I play.
That's great.
And so it's all these like ambient music things, and yeah, that's what I would probably try to do.
Cool.
It would never make money.
I think maybe your previous question answered this one. So, but if you could have worked on any film or project, what would it be?
So is this like a theoretical one that they haven't made yet?
No, like one that exists out there.
Oh, Lord of the Rings, for
yeah.
sure.
Yeah, that's what I thought. That's what I thought.
For sure. But no, I was thinking about like, you know, is it one that hasn't been made, which I'm kind of surprised, is they've not done a proper version of the Odyssey, like Homer's The Iliad / Odyssey.
Yeah.
Like, I know that they've done Troy and stuff like that, but, like, they haven't done the Lord of the Rings take on epic fantasy for the Odyssey. Because you have the Cyclops, you have all these massive things that you can totally tell with modern technology would be really difficult and definitely couldn't fit in one film. Hey, franchise, that's what it's all about.
Right? You're just looking for job security, man. You're just looking for multiple films.
Well, you know, it was funny. Before I got into animation, I actually had this mental list of, like, things I really want to work on. And Lord of the Rings was one of them. And I remember being just elated when it came out and also disappointed.
Yeah.
It's like, I made it.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. And then they just started a bunch of the Harry Potter stuff.
Yeah.
So, okay, so that by the time that I graduate college, that'll be done.
Yeah.
And The Odyssey is the one thing that was on my original list that hasn't been made yet. So I would love to work on The Odyssey.
All right. Well, we've got a couple more questions here for Dorien Gunnels, future VFX soup on the Odyssey films. We have, would you say working as a lighting artist in animation is more enjoyable than VFX?
So I haven't actually worked professionally in VFX, so I can't give a definite answer on that.
Mm-hmm.
I can only say I really enjoy the artistic input that you have in animation because, mm-hmm. again, you're not lighting to a plate. There is no technical right or wrong,
mm-hmm.
Which is both terrifying and awesome at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Because again, it's an open book, and it's really about it's a battle of opinions at that point. It's like, oh no, we should move the room like this way. So I really enjoy animation, but I'm very interested to try out live action and see how it compares.
Cool. Yeah, it's great. So there's a question about visa stuff, and I'll answer a little bit of this, and then I'll ask you a question. So because the question is, what if you don't live in the U.S. or Canada? Is it a problem with a working visa? And I would say that, and I don't know about you, Dorien, but I would say that neither of us are the best at answering that. So I would suggest that you reach out to a company's HR department and talk to them, because I know different companies have different rules, especially like US is different than Canada. It's harder if you don't have a college degree to get a job, especially in the US. But I will spin this to a question for Dorien. Dorien, was there any difficulty when you went to work up in Vancouver as an American citizen?
So as an American citizen, no, because there's definitely like hoops to jump there, but it's not as big of a barrier as maybe as it is for other countries. I'm not sure what the country person is asking about, but it kind of doesn't matter. There's in general, when you get a job, either in the US or in Canada, the company can sponsor you for a work visa.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really, the difficulty of getting that work visa, it can sometimes be substantial.
Mm-hmm.
So it really is about selling your stuff to the company and making sure that you're worth it to the company. Sony was able to make it pretty easy for me. But of course, those work visas are temporary. So at some point, you either want to, if you plan on staying or anything like that, you should, while you're there, maybe explore either green card in the US or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, I've definitely heard in the US it can be a difficult thing. I'm an American citizen, so I've never.
Yeah.
I've never had to experience that, but I've definitely had some friends that are from Italy, Spain, that have had some headaches.
I should say that this is a very international industry, and we have people from all over the world working here at Blue Sky, and it's a very international friendly industry. One more question on here, and we'll see if any more pop up, but does your lighting workflow in scenes, in your lighting workflow, do you use fake lights to paint the scene to be able to better the light balance? And I'm guessing that's like, do you do things based on photo reality, or do you break the rules sometimes to paint the scene to a more aesthetic?
To hit? Absolutely. Yeah. And they'll do that in live action as well, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But even in animation, it's a really, really good idea, especially when you're starting out, like not starting out your career, but starting out a scene.
Mm-hmm.
To light it as physically plausible as possible, especially in modern renderers, where it's like old school renderman was like the whole thing was fake,
right?
So you're kind of having to think about how would this actually work? But here, everything is path traced and all this stuff. So it's you have physical shaders, you have physical lights, use it physically, mm-hmm. and then. Once you have, right now I've got this massive window over here that's, providing some fill, make that happen. And then if it doesn't look good, it's add a little bit of fill or then plus it.
Mm.
But the more you ground your scene in reality, the better it's going to look. Unless you're going for something super, super stylized, but that's a double-edged sword too, because if it's stylized, you want to make sure that it comes off as purposely stylized and not a mistake. So definitely ground yourself in reality.
And then, that's great. And then our last question is just from Francesco Giraldini, just saying hi from DreamWorks.
Hi.
So we've got a little
blue sky. DreamWorks together.
Oh, wow. And that's just to reiterate what a small industry this is. So these guys,
sure.
Yeah.
I've got a lot of good stories.
Well, Dorien, thank you very much for joining us. If you guys have any other questions for Dorien, please feel free to add them to the comments, as this video will be online for a little bit. I will reach out to him because it gives me a reason to talk to him and stay in touch and do all that good stuff. So, Dorien,
right,
thank
I
you.
Lurk around on the Facebook group too.
Yes. Yes, he does lurk around sometimes, and we appreciate that. And I'm putting you on the spot. We will want Dorien at some point, once we get the TDU bunny, we're going to ask Dorien to do a lighting walkthrough. So make sure you guys pressure him to get him to do that too. Yeah, the bunny's going to be great. So Dorien Gunnels, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. And we look forward to seeing what amazing things you do next. And congratulations on getting the job on the Odyssey films. That's great. All right. Talk to you soon. Bye, everybody.
Cheers, man.